like sheep without a shepherd. We wander around the desert and wind up following the wrong gods home. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Many of our gospel lessons teach us by inspiring fear and awe. You remember the parable of the wedding feast, which we read the 21st Sunday after Trinity, where a poorly dressed guest is thrown out of the hall for being poorly dressed. We gasp in shock as the man, for a seemingly minor offense, is not only cast out the door, but is cast into the outer darkness of hell. But today's reading, the Good Shepherd, is not such a gospel. One reason it seems to be so gentle is our pastoral, bucolic image of sheep. The English poet and mystic William Blake writes of such sheep as having clothing of delight, softest clothing, woolly bright, with such a tender voice, making all the vales rejoice. Another reason for the gentleness of this morning's reading is the image of the caring shepherd. Now, of course, as we sit here this morning, we are all very sure that we are among the 99 sheep that do not stray from the fold. But it is reassuring to know that if at some point in our lives we become the one that is missing, there is a shepherd who will faithfully search for us. So today's reading seems to be a simple, gentle, pleasing gospel. Little to add, not much more to say. End of sermon. Well, no. In the immortal words of the sports commentator Lee Corso, not so fast, my friends. Bishop Robert Barron, from the Archdiocese of Los Angeles, in an excellent article entitled Amazed and Afraid, reminds us initially that the image of the divine shepherd begins in the Old Testament. In the book of Jeremiah, the Lord promises he will set up a shepherd over them, which shall feed them, and they shall fear no more, nor be dismayed, neither shall they be lacking. But more importantly, Bishop Barron wants to point out to us that Jesus is sometimes ruthlessly efficient in his gathering of the flock. He is perfectly willing to overturn social and cultural standards of his day. Remember back in the third Sunday of Lent, a woman cried out to Jesus, "Blessed is the womb that bare thee, and the paps which thou hast sucked." Jesus quickly dismisses this family relationship. Yea, rather, blessed art they that hear the word of God and keep it. For Jesus, who is the good shepherd, the gathering of the kingdom, the gathering of the flock, becomes even more important than this mother-son relationship. In another story, a possible disciple says he will follow Jesus, but first must bury his father. Jesus replies in a seemingly uncaring manner, "Let the dead bury the dead." Once again, the gathering of the Old Testament kingdom, the gathering of the New Testament flock, supersedes family matters, becomes even more important than this father-son relationship. Jesus tells his potential flock point blank that he came to set a man at variance against his father, and the daughter against her mother, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. The sheep will be gathered, even at the expense of the family, even at the expense of society. And the good shepherd will not leave the flock. He will defeat the wolves, the enemies of the nation, and the enemies of the kingdom. Jesus will become a warrior shepherd, but a warrior in the strangest way. 3 weeks ago, in a moment of his greatest triumph, his entry into Jerusalem, Jesus does the strangest thing. He goes to the temple and with whips of cords, drives out the money changers, overturning their tables. He irritates both the Jews for profaning the temple and the Romans for fomenting civil unrest. This one act of heroic defiance virtually guarantees Jesus' arrest, persecution, and eventual death. But he doesn't mind it, because he is the warrior shepherd. In his final days, Jesus is faced with corruption, violence, stupidity, injustice, cruelty, betrayal, and denial from the Jews, from the Romans, and astonishingly, from his own disciples. He is surrounded by enemies, the soldier in Caiaphas' court who struck him with his fist, Pilate who condemned God in exchange for popularity, Herod who robed wisdom with the garment of a fool, and the Romans who hung the King of Kings on a tree. But as the warrior shepherd, Jesus ignores all of these. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. As the warrior shepherd, he rejects the use of power. Now, Jesus could have stopped the suffering of the passion at any point during the questioning of the Pharisees, during the interrogation of Herod. And remember, he could have come down from the cross as the crowds taunted him to do. But he chose not to do so. He gave his life for his flock. As the warrior shepherd, Jesus rejects the use of the sword. Are ye come out as against a thief with swords and staves to take me? Instead, the warrior giveth his life for the flock. What Bishop Barron ultimately wants us to see is that when we hear of Jesus as the good shepherd, he is not just a kind and gentle shepherd, although at times he is both of these. Jesus is instead the good shepherd, the relentless shepherd, the efficient shepherd, who will stop at nothing to gather all his flock, who will stop at nothing to save all their souls. Yes, Jesus is a stern and relentless shepherd and does make certain demands on his flock, but these demands can hardly match the demand that he makes upon himself. I lay down my life for my sheep. And in the end, in one of the great Christian paradoxes, the warrior shepherd becomes one of his own sacrificial lambs. William Blake once again, he is meek and he is mild. He became a little child. He is called by thy name, for he calls himself a lamb. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Where are you pastoring your flock, O good shepherd, who carry the whole flock on your shoulders? Show us the place of peace. Lead us to the good grass that will nourish us. Call us by name, so that we, your sheep, will hear your voice. And by your speech, give us eternal life.